It's either Tuesday.
No, actually,
No, I think he did shut it off for our break.
Well, we'll not wait for him to come back.
Now, what are we going through now?
Okay. Are we back on?
Yes.
Council's coming back to order from a break. And item number six, discussion on reduced hours at the town hall. We have some graphs here showing, not graphs, what's the word I want to use?
Spreadsheets.
Tables, charts. There you go, charts.
Turn that back on.
I'm not sure that we have to go into a whole lot of detail on this. We've talked about this before. We've asked the administrator to please
You gotta turn that back.
Provide a cost analysis on this. Excuse me. We have those figures. I don't think we're going to see a whole lot of savings from one year to the other, but I think if we put this in this year, we'll start seeing some of those figures results next May when we actually implement this. So is there a motion on the table to do this, and then we can go into discussion?
To do what?
To adopt the proposed plan of going to 4 days a week, and I'm assuming the hours would be from 8 a.m. to...
No, the hours that we would have would be 7 a.m. to 5:30. So we'd be open earlier in the morning, which would provide residents who, you know, are leaving early and want to come in and take care of some business. They can do that. And we'd be open till 5:30 to catch the folks coming in on the evening and Monday through Thursday.
Because that works well in the clerk's office, doesn't it?
It works well for in there from what they had. But it... Also, being from 4:30, that extra hour, we'd pick up some additional folks to do that.
Councilor Quox?
So we wouldn't have any evening hours for the, because I know,
We would still have, obviously, there'd be meetings Monday through Thursday, because that's generally when the bulk of our meetings. Mm. So the building would still be in use. I'm saying that the office hours for staff.
Yeah, but the town clerk is usually open till 7 on...
Monday.
Yep. So does she have a lot of people utilizing those hours? People
I'm sure
who
she
work
does. Mm-hmm. I'm sure she
in?
Does.
So would that be detrimental to people getting used to using?
No, and we'd work that out with Becky Ben Minuti.
Okay.
You know, so that way we're not disrupting that Monday that everybody expects that time is.
Yeah.
She might be leaving, or the office might even close a little bit early on Thursdays.
Yeah.
You know, because of that. But the goal is that, you know, we shorten up the time frame, and we have 3 days that the building is shut down, you know, utilizing the thermostats that we have to reduce the temperature in all the rooms and save some fuel. I just quickly ran some numbers that if we're paying $3 a gallon for fuel under doing this program and just saving, you know, a third of our heating costs, that's $7,000 that we would be saving the taxpayer for that period of time, from which would be from the beginning of November to the end of March.
And you did mention the other day when I was in your office that some of the employees that schedule's not going to work out for them, so that Friday...
Correct. We have two employees
so
that,
far.
Because of family... Well, everybody that we've talked to, those are, we only have two that,
okay.
that it impacts, and they've agreed to, you know, continue to work their eight-hour day, and on Fridays, we would locate one of them over at the Public Works garage, and what they would do is spend... Not the garage, but at the building... So that
day number three.
Yeah, really. And the goal is that we would utilize the laser fiche system and start scanning in. They're mostly planning documents. Start scanning them in, and you know, it'd be unbroken time to do that. And the other one, we would set up over at the police department, so that they could access the computers and still do the work that they do. It's in finance. So.
Yeah, that would be great. And it'd be good too before you know anyone leaves Thursday is to make sure the windows are, I mean, the winter they're usually shut, but sometimes it gets hot in here and people open them a crack, and make sure the blinds is not open like this and sealed. But
and we're also going to send a memo around. Everybody shuts down all their computers. Any electrical items that you have, shut them down.
Definitely.
So that way, to the maximum extent. And this is in all departments.
Mm-hmm. That'll save some money.
We're talking pretty much here.
We're just talking about
You know, for the town hall, but in all departments, that we shut them down at the end of the day and make sure the temperatures are done. We're still going to put in the infrared sensors for the electrical. I was talking with the superintendent about putting them in his offices upstairs. He's excited about doing that, so that way when they're not there, the lights will still go out if nobody's in an office.
Is the school department going to be out of here on Friday?
No, they won't. They're still going to be here. But, you know, it'll only be their offices that will be drawing heat, but we're going to put the thermostats in so that they're following the same routine.
Can we, is there any way we can meter the heat for them? I know in some units, even if you have one furnace, you can somehow meter the heat as to how much they're using. I mean, it doesn't, if we're going to close the whole building down, I mean, are they on a separate zone? Completely separate zone up there?
No, I don't believe that.
So if they have it at 70, the whole building's at 70.
Well, the goal is that we won't have the building at 70 during the winter. We've talked about that. It is probably keeping it at 68. You know, we'll just wear an extra sweater.
If they're going to be there Friday, it's not worth it. That
well,
defeats the whole
it's
purpose.
It's only two rooms, three rooms that are affected.
But if they have the heat
thing
on up there, it's the heat on this floor is going to be doing. It's not. We'll have lights off, and that's going to be it.
No.
No?
Do they have their own thermostat?
Yes.
Well, then it is separately zoned.
Because we have our own down here.
Yeah. Every room, that's what I'm saying, is that you have the two rooms, the three rooms that they utilize up there would have their own thermostats. All the rest of our, this room right here would be set at 55, so it would be at 55.
And all the rooms have their own thermostats?
Yep. We all have our own thermostats. That's why we had them all changed out, so that way we can, those are all programmable, which, you know, at the end of, right now at this time of the year, at 10 o'clock the temperature goes up, you know, to 70 degrees so that the air conditioner isn't kicking on.
And do they have us upstairs, do they have a separate electricity bill, or we pay the electricity bill?
I believe that we pay and then we apportion out a cost to them. That's the way it works. So it's 1 meter.
And they do the same thing with the oil.
That's
they
correct.
Get a portion and then they pay it to the town what they use.
But the superintendent, you know, he and they can't because of the school itself. He was telling me that they've had some discussion at the state level.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very difficult to just for them to jump into that because they have students that go to other school systems for different type of programming, so it's very difficult for them to just say we're going to go to a 4-day work week. We can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
They have to plan that well in advance to do that, and there has to be a lot of collaboration from the different SAUs and things. So, but you know, talking with the superintendent, he's committed towards working with us to reduce the cost overall for that 1 day.
Just to let the council know, also, I've spoken with the council rep to the school board, and he's going to set up a meeting for October where we'll be looking at, I talked with the chair, Cliff, and we're going to set up an agenda in the meeting separate from all our other meetings and talk about cost sharing, and that's one of the issues that we'll be looking at is cost sharing, how we can share some of the costs. And Council LaBranch, you have a question?
Actually, a couple in regard to this. How What months are you contemplating doing this?
Starting November 3rd and going to the end of March. That in April, we would be back on a regular 8-hour, 5 days a week.
How, no, understanding that that's the bad time of year for a lot of people, how does that affect the welfare office and our requirements for keeping the welfare office open?
One of the things that the welfare director has tried is to have people make appointments. So that way people aren't coming in, because she also has other responsibilities, and that's what takes up a great deal of her time. She's one of the employees that has a problem with working four 10-hour days. So we could still have her available. She could still be available. It would just be over at the Public Works building if people needed to have some kind of assistance emergency during that period of time. But also, again, by being open, well, she would be available over at the Public Works for that.
Okay. During that time frame, there's also a number of holidays that are off. I could see a situation, for example, week of Christmas, where Town Hall might be open 2 days.
We are closed on Thursday and Friday of this year.
Yeah.
I mean, that was agreed at the end of last year, where we agreed that we would set a schedule and say these are the Christmas holidays.
Understood. But if Friday's a day off, how do you pay the employees for that day that they're now going to have to take off anyway? You understand what I'm saying?
Don Parnell and I had a conversation about that, because one employee came to me and we started talking. She said, well, okay, Thursday and Friday is off for Christmas, and I've already scheduling Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. But that's 30 hours. So Don and I said, okay, for this we're going to have to make an exception that we would charge 8 hours of time for that person, because if we're taking what would be normally 24 hours if we were on a regular 8-hour work week, and you're taking three of those days and it adds up to 30, you're sort of disenfranchising the employee. So we would make an exception and say we'll charge that 8 hours for that, unless you're going to take a week off, then you're going to have 40 hours. You're going to have those 40 hours come right off. But we're just going to have to adjust that, and we'll deal with it on a case-by-case basis for the employees in the building.
Okay, thank you.
Because it's just not fair to disenfranchise somebody, where especially like there's one individual who is working 8 hours per day. He's going to be working 5 days, 8 hours. She's taking 3 days off, which would be 24, but she's going to be here the other 2 days, even though it's 1 day in the building and 1 day over at Public Works. So we'll deal with that on a case-by-case basis. There's some learning curves to this.
What you just said strikes a point with me, where you mentioned about two individuals having to place them in other locations, but if we're going to be already utilizing the upstairs because the school is functioning, isn't there any way that they could give them a little space to operate so that they're still in Town Hall, so that the people that generally would be going to see these people or calling these people, that they'd still be accessible in the same building? Is that a possibility or no?
It probably is. I haven't had that conversation. But knowing the offices upstairs by the SAU are pretty full. Our goal is try to limit the amount of, if it becomes a problem that we now are starting to have an additional office open for those two people, then we're sort of beginning to defeat our purpose. The goal that we're trying to do is shut down as much of the building as we can. I think it'll work out. It might be a small inconvenience for the people to come to, like, the DPW garage to meet with her, but we can still manage that.
Okay. Another point that just popped in my head.
Sure.
You've got, basically, you're saying that this facility is going to be on a 4-day week. Why are we not looking at DPW as potentially being a four-day week also.
It's probably the busiest time of the year.
Well, I understand that, which is all the more reason to maybe say that, you know, generally their work week would be Monday through Thursday, barring storms, which are, you know, normal work hours for them anyway. You know, I guess, you know, if I'm trying to look at it as, okay, we can save a little here, we can save a little there. Knowing the size of the facility for DPW, if you can shut that down for an extra day, you know, or lower the temps, you can, I mean, the savings you've got in town hall are probably minimal compared to what you could save down there.
True, but the busy, you know, one of the things that a lot of communities do is they will have 4 10-hour days during the summertime because they utilize more of, you know, you get the crew out at a particular project, there's more daylight, they can get those things done. In the winter, you know, the time that we're talking about is the winter time where you could have, you know, a snowstorm on Monday, and then, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, you got another storm that's mm-hmm. there. So it, by having the 10 hours, if there's not a lot to do, then you've got personnel not so much sitting around, but it's kind of difficult to be out on the side of the road doing maybe some ditch work or cutting trees and stuff like that. It's better use of your manpower during the summer when you have the light versus in the fall, and you have snowstorms that come at any point in time.
Okay, thanks.
Councilor Bergeron?
I'm just trying to wrap my mind around this a little bit. In the winter, you're going to do this only, and you're going to save oil and electricity by reducing the hours that the building is used. What are your setbacks going to be? I mean, how far back are you dialing this building that you're going to save that much money?
Probably down to 55.
55?
Yep. And the high will be at 68.
Okay.
And we'll set it such that, like, you know, we come in here at 7 o'clock, it would start raising the temperature, sort of at maybe 6:30 or so. Maybe. And, you know, at 5:30, it just drops the temperature down. Except, like, with this room, if it's being used at it this room would stay at 55 until like at the 7 o'clock meeting. It's not coming up probably at 6:30, quarter after six, come up to 68 degrees. 10 o'clock is usually when the committee meetings get done. It starts dropping it right after that.
What about the hallways and stairwells?
They don't there's no thermostats for them.
They just get whatever heat comes right into them. Okay. Why not in the summer? Now, see, in this winter, you're going to be able to save electricity and fuel.
Yep.
In the summer, you'd be able to save a lot of electricity on air conditioning costs.
Well, and it's interesting because when you look at the costs, our biggest costs are electric, are in the summertime.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, we only use about 35-36% of the electric costs during the months we're going to be closed, whereas, you know, June, July, August, and September are our highest months. You know, I guess that's a discussion that we should have.
Well, why aren't we doing this year round is what I'm saying. Why just winter? Because you're saving both ends of the spectrum. Yeah.
I think that the issue is that
this is sort of a new territory that we're going into because of the situation we have. I've talked with a couple other employees and said, you know, that's not a bad idea to be, you know, we're here 4 days a week, and the building's closed to save electricity when it's the most greatest use, and heat.
Or but the building oil, is open it? Longer. It's, you know, it's still a 10-hour day.
Yep,
it's an adjustment for everybody all the way around.
And I guess I'd like to have that conversation because, you know, we're going to monitor this, and if we see that we're really having some savings, you know, at that point, it becomes worthwhile for us to have that
practically
that
impossible to calculate what savings right. you would get out of this.
Yeah, that's why I just said, you know, a third. If we make that, then we're going to be doing well.
Okay. Councilor LaBranche?
If we're going to do this as a trial, I'd rather see tables with, for example, kilowatt hours and things of that nature instead of dollar cost, because with fluctuating prices, it's an unfair comparison.
Yep.
So I think in order to get a true read on this, and I'm not sure if we can utilize gallons. I mean, I don't know if we pinpoint when deliveries happened last year for oil.
Yes, we can.
You know, so I would rather see it on kilowatts, kilowatt hours and gallons as opposed to dollars and cents.
Well, if you look on the sheet that I gave you, especially for like the heating fuel, it gives you the cost and then it gives you the amount of gallons that came in.
Mm-hmm. So we should see a reduction.
Right. Yes. We should see reduction in kilowatt hours, yep, and gallons, but not necessarily in dollars and cents.
Correct.
Because
that's correct.
But yeah, in reality, we are saving money because we're not using those extra,
correct,
kilowatt hours or gallons.
Well, the, yep, gallonage will also give us
that. Right. Yeah. So, I mean, I think that if we're going to do this as a trial, to me, that's the table we want to be looking at, mm-hmm, of the, yep, comparison.
Perhaps all three. Kilowatts, the gallons, and, yep, the dollar amount.
And we can, and, yeah, we can easily start working on that and putting, yeah, that together.
That's such a good,
yep,
point. One of the, I guess I'm not going to talk. Councilor Quox.
Have we?
I'd like to move this on.
Have, folks, we initiated anything into the DPW, mm, building regarding their lights off and on, those monitors you said, and their heat for their rooms?
They have these, the similar type of, mm-hmm, thermostats there. I talked with Rick Malaski about that. Relative to the switches, no. And we'll begin incorporating. In fact, I talked with the police chief during our department head meeting today about that. Mm-hmm. You know, he doesn't have a problem putting them in there. Yeah. That way, you know, if offices are unoccupied. The only thing that we're not going to put it in is like in the hallways here. When we're,
yeah,
here, the lights will always be on.
Yeah.
It'd probably be disconcerting, yeah, for some people if they walk in and the light turns on. It's like, what, mm-hmm, just happened? Yeah. So.
Okay.
You also have a higher foot traffic in DPW constantly coming in. Are you talking like the Bay Area,
well,
or the offices?
I'm talking in the offices. I mean, it's just like, you know, I mean, it's I was talking with Councilor Quox earlier, and, you know, it's like I left the building because I went to a meeting, and I thought I flipped the light switch off when I left. You know, I'm driving back to the building here, and I see, God, I left the lights on. How stupid of me. You know, trying to at least get into that, and that's what we're trying to do.
Okay, I just had a thought also, and I'd like to wrap this up. One of the people you said was in the
planning
office there, and the other one I'm assuming is
finance.
The finance department. So if the upstairs is going to be running anyways, and warm air rises, so that upstairs is going to be warm, why not allow them both to work in the finance office? They're already upstairs, so it's being utilized.
If I'm assuming that if we have the building fairly cold from the basement and up, I mean, there's not a lot of heat that's rising. It's the heat that's just naturally generated by the offices that are there.
But even the heat that's on that third floor from those other offices, the doors are open all the time, you might find out that they may not be that uncomfortable working up there.
We can.
And plus, all the files are downstairs here, and her files are right upstairs, rather than putting them off somewhere and have to duplicate the files.
Yeah. That's an idea.
Actually her idea.
I don't have a problem with that.
Picked up one. Okay. So we're going to need this in the form of a motion to try this on a trial basis, November 3rd to March 31st. What day does that fall on?
Well, you can't look on that calendar.
Oh, actually, I do right here.
Third. It's a Monday to March 31st. Oh, don't have March 31st.
March right here. 09. Oops, that's February. 09. March 31st is actually on a Tuesday, so we probably should
go to the end of that week.
Yeah, March 27th, which is on a Friday. So starting March 30th, they go back to the regular 8 hours, unless the council decides cost effectiveness was there and you may want to
continue it.
Yeah, continue it. Yeah. So I will entertain that as a motion.
So moved.
That was easy.
Second.
Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Quox?
Aye.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor LaBranche?
Aye.
Councilor Minutelli?
Aye.
Councilor Carr?
Aye.
Chairman Glennon?
Aye. Okay. Town Council, Center nomination, appointments, and elections.
Town Council Gold?
Aye.
Oh, did I skip that?
You skipped that.
I'm sorry, I skipped it. Yep, all right. Council goals. Did you all get a, what did I do with mine? Did you all get a copy of it?
Yes.
Now, I just want to look at something real closely here. Let's go down the energy audit. We have that going tonight. We had some discussion on that. I guess I want to look at the water. Let's take the water one. We know that that's already in progress. That's coming along, and the council's been working on it. We're going to get updates. And other than updates, I'm not sure what else we could really do. So, but it was up there. It was a number four. And then when we look at holding the line, housekeeping, that was a number six. Everybody agreed with that. Actually, there was one that put it as a priority, yeah, number three. So we know that's a given. The budget issue, that's going to be an ongoing one. And where I'm going with this, I'll tell you in a second. The budget issue is one in which we all know we're going to have really serious discussion in. And I'm assuming that Councillor LaBranche, as our council rep to the Budget Committee, is going to really work hard on those numbers. So that's also a given. That's already going to be working in progress. And then we go to the M1 rezoning. My understanding is that having a conversation today with the Vice Chair as our council rep to the Planning Board and also having a conversation with the town planner, it appears that that is going to go to the September 30th will be a public hearing. Hopefully that will be the last public hearing. And I've asked the Vice Chair here to check with the Planning Board Chairman to see when we can get that on the agenda for October. And that, again, will be another meeting separate from our other meetings, so we can have a joint meeting with the Planning Board and the Council to have a discussion on that. So that one's already in the working progress also. So if we kind of take, I'm not going to say take them out of the issue, out of the equation, because they are there. And if I look at it, one of them right now would be number six, would be a number one priority. And then if I look at number two, consolidating town and school similar expenditures, i.e. supplies, healthcare, and all that, that's something we're going to work on in October at a special meeting with that. So those are two that we can do right away. And if we put a third one in there, the third one probably would be, there's another four in here. Oh, the energy audit, we're going to be working on that with a committee. Water, we're going to be working on. So it leaves either historical district or strategic planning. Now, historical district, in my conversation with the chair there, and Councillor Quox can really touch base on this one, they're at a point now where their ordinance is pretty much wrapping up, right? You've been spending months and months on this, on
right.
that issue.
And it is a land use ordinance, so that has been taken to, the information that they've compiled has been taken to Diane Hardy in the planning office, okay. And she'll be working on it. So
okay.
it's in the trenches.
And they've been following the request of the previous council, which is delineation of the historical district as set by federal guidelines. And they were also asked to contact anybody within the historical district, which they've done. 9 hours already?
No.
Oh. And then
the batteries are almost dead.
They've been also asked to delineation, contact the people. What was the other one? There was three. Councilor Branch, remember? There was three things they wanted done. They got them all done.
Yeah.
The ordinance, maybe it was. It was
yeah.
the ordinance. And they've done that. So they're coming to the council sometime in October, maybe November, for a discussion on that. So I kind of won't take that one out, but I'll move that one. So at this point, I think what we need to do is now go back.
October 14th, we're going to Planning Board. It's going to be discussed at Planning Board, and we're planning on coming to Council October 15th.
Okay, I'll try to get it on the agenda, but we have a very heavy agenda and...
I think it's just a, probably just an update type of thing.
An intro, like, okay.
Yeah, just to let you know what's going on.
We can do that.
Okay.
Mr. Winowski, please put that down for me, because I'm not going to write it. So that kind of leaves us going back to number six, number two, and the rest of them, well, strategic planning would be number three. Now, with the strategic planning, it also says in our charter that the council should meet on an annual basis with all of its committees. And this is exactly the goal that was intended for this particular strategic planning. That's something that's not going to happen overnight. It's probably going to take months to organize it, set it up, and I would envision probably something happening sometime in, I would say, the budget cycle comes in, we have to go through that. I would say probably sometime in the middle of April. Pretty much all the budget is gone and stuff like that. So, where's the council on this? Where would you like to see moving things? Or do you just, what are your thoughts? And the other question I have, which nobody filled out other than Councilor, I think it was Councilor Bergeron, now one of the councilors, I'm sorry, I don't remember which one it was, but actually looked at the second page and made recommendations on how we can achieve these goals. I think actually it was two councilors. One said we should, at every workshop, we should leave one there, work on it until it gets done. Mm-hmm. And then we go to the second one, then we go to the third one until it gets done. And we go that route. Councilor Quox.
Water. What about water?
Water we are working on.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
It's one of those that we can't do anything else right now. We got to wait for the studies to come in. We can certainly do what Councilor LaBranch has suggested before was to get them to come in and talk to us and tell us where we are. And they're coming in October to have that discussion along with
right.
these other studies.
That's right. Here. Okay.
Okay. Well said.
Mm-hmm.
Councilor LaBranch?
As far as water is concerned, my whole philosophy on this is, you know, unless somebody brings it up, we don't get any answers. Now, I could ask the question, where are we on our second water tank? And I'm pretty confident that there's been little, if any, discussion between the property owner that we need to talk to and having this tank put up, which the council has already approved. Which, listening to Sean this evening, that's another 750,000 gallons of water that we would have in supply.
And I did ask him that question this week. We did have that conversation.
Yep.
Yeah. And you want to fill him in?
Just that I need to have that discussion as to the plan that we would like to have them do it and have it surveyed, as get a cost as to what they'd like to sell it for.
But what's holding that up? I guess that's our
just have a discussion with them.
Okay, but what I'm getting at, and this is one example, you know, we're not talking to the property owner at this point, which is if we don't have the property or the easement or whatever, the right of way, what good does having this tank being ready to be put up, being ready to fill? Same situation with the well that we're looking at. We have proposals, we've received some proposals, and we haven't acted on it. And I know we received the proposal several weeks ago, and there's been no non-public meeting on it. So,
you're
I mean, that's...
Emery Garrett? Are you
no, I'm talking the well.
The well that we were talking about.
Or the wells. We'll refer to them as
mm-hmm.
the wells. But that's what I'm getting at, is unless, and I've been adamant about trying to bring these things up at various meetings, because I feel like we're not, as a council, being informed of where we are with these situations, or we're not moving forward for A, either lack of time, or B, lack of attention.
I think it's both. We also had that conversation, and you were waiting for an agreement with the landowner to finally make up his mind. Part of this, some of this, is the land, the people who own the land, to make up their mind officially. And Councilor Quox and I had a conversation about this this evening, early this afternoon rather, and what I'm going to inform the council is next Wednesday when we have our non-public for the two issues we have. We'll also would like to add that to the agenda on that property, and so we can get some real hard discussion going on. And you're right, and I'll take some of that blame, but we did have that conversation the other day when we were talking with Sean.
I'm not trying to put the blame on anyone.
No,
what I'm saying
you
is,
you have a very good point.
You know, 3 years ago, when I ran for the first time, mm-hmm. the people on candidates night sat there and got badgered by what are we doing about water? What are we doing about water? And that was one of the things that I said was going to be my goal while I was a counselor, is to find another source.
Yep.
The council has found, theoretically, two other sources, but we haven't moved on them. And that's why I feel that it really needs to be brought up almost every meeting, even if it's just to say, I have nothing to report. Then we can say, okay, well, geez, you know, you haven't talked to the property owner, or you haven't talked to Emery and Garrett, or you haven't, you know, what's the status? And you know, it's just something that I feel is that it's at the top of my list.
No, and I agree with you, and I think it's evident by the council survey that it is on there. We did talk about it. It is on the agenda. As you see here, it's coming in October. We're going to talk about it next Wednesday. And I can certainly understand your frustration on that. So we will take action. You all set?
Yes.
I agree with Councilor Branch. I'd probably like to see if we're going to discuss that other property in non-public. I'd like to instruct the town administrator to get in touch with that property owner and let them know that we want
a decision,
but he's a P&S type of thing, and that's it, because we can't move forward until then. And I like the way Julie does it when she gives us her reports as to who's what decision was made and who's responsible for the follow through. We need some type of a tickler list, or that each week that it has to be brought up. And have it written down so we don't forget. And whoever was responsible to do that has to have done it during the week and get that information to us, because it is slipping through the cracks. And we can't wait any longer.
Okay.
Okay. Moving on.
Very good. So where do you want to go with this? The water certainly is going to be, none of these, when I say we're working on them, I'm not suggesting at all that we're not going to have further discussions. We certainly will have those, and we should have them. Councilor Branch, are you comfortable with, like, say, at our workshop, or do you want it, like, every meeting? And the rest of the council, weigh in on that, too, please.
If we're receiving new information on a monthly basis, I don't care if it's business meeting or workshop. Mm-hmm. As long as we're, as a council, as a group, we discuss it, non-public or in public, depending on the situation. I just would like to see it on an agenda strictly as item 10, water.
Okay.
You know, where are we? And at least it gives the public the chance to see that we are bringing it up every month. And, you know, we are working. I mean, I talk with the administrator a lot about, you know, where he's at with different things. It's not like we're not working, but I'm talking to the administrator. The rest of the council doesn't know what discussions we've had, and if the chair's talking to the administrator, the rest of the council probably doesn't know what the conversation was. So we're all getting bits and pieces, and I would just like to see, you know, a flat statement made on, we've done this, we've done that, we're going to do this next.
How about if we did something like this? On the agenda, we have a section that says update, and we can put specifically certain things that we're working on, update. Water would be one, energy might be another one. What else is in here that's had a high priority? Budget issues, because that would come from you from the monthly report.
That's fine, and actually, if you go back to the previous administration, the administrator did give, I know, The current administrator gives us his weekly updates, which are great. You know, they're very informative.
More
and everything else.
There.
But the previous administration would actually sit in that seat and give the council an update on maybe a monthly basis of what was going on with certain things, so that it was public, so the people were hearing it, the councils were all hearing it at the same time, and they could ask a question if there was anything that was brought up. So maybe that's what we could do. Maybe we could go back to having an item on the agenda that would be administrators' remarks, comments, updates.
Yep.
Maybe that's not a bad idea. But I still want the weekly ones. I do enjoy reading.
So as the three of us meet on a every other week, as the three of us do meet, and we set the agenda. It's not set by me. I may have the final say on it, but it's an agenda where we all, three of us, sit there and we look at it and we talk about it. So we'll add a update to the agenda list, and that could be down at the bottom. Yep. Perhaps just before new business and old business, we can add that to that. And Councilor Quox.
I also think maybe the council should have some input as to the request of items they want to see on the agenda.
Oh, that's always open. I usually say it at the end of the meeting. Does anybody want to add anything to the agenda?
Something like water, or say the PNS, the well type of thing, say we definitely want this on the agenda. And something that we do not want not to see there the next month. If the board feels it's important enough that we want to keep it current and get it going, I think the council should.
Well, you want to be careful where you're going with that, because it is under the preview of the chair to set the agenda, and the chair has, not just me, the chair has things that other people are giving us to in the town that want to have on there. So when I say I'll get it on the agenda as soon as I can, if it's a huge issue like you had suggested next week, yes, that will be on there, because that is a huge priority. So we'll always work to accommodate it, absolutely, and we've done that.
Tried to
do it. So you're all set. Okay, so does the council, what do you want to do? Let's pick three goals here so we can start working on them, and then I'll try to set up something on how the process should work and get input. Council can give me input too by way of email, say, you know, we got two people already that have suggested ways of doing it, and we'll look at those. I'll include those. But right now, when I saw this the other night, this is, gee, we're working on water, the energy is going to come up tonight. Budget is something we're constantly working on, it's coming up. So where do you really want to go? Councilor Bergeron.
Black Bear TIF, I'd like to see moved up the ladder as well. I think that's kind of been languishing. I'd like to see that kind of.
Well, no, I'm talking about the way the council has set it as priorities, because the council, when you look at this, there was one that put it as a number one, there was two that put it as two, and there was four. I'm not suggesting we change the numbers to move over. I'm suggesting we look at the number one category and look at those priorities and see how we can get those through first. And then we can go over to the two and the three and whatever else categories there are there. Because otherwise, we're going to have to do the survey all over again.
I'm working on most of these.
Yeah, a lot of them we are. I mean,
what to say?
I mean, if you want to think about it, send me an email. We can do that, because we're not going to start the process tonight. Anyways, yes. Go ahead.
What are you you're looking to us to give you guidance as to how we want to handle this?
No. What are your? Now that we went through this, we said the energy is being worked on.
Right.
We know that the number two is a priority. We know that number
six
is a priority based on the numbers. And the rest of these we're kind of looking at. We're already in process working. So let's pick three that we can start working on simultaneously with what we're doing with the others.
If I may?
Yeah.
I see, as far as the rezoning with the M1 district and the M4, that's something planning board does and brings it to us. So when they're ready to bring it to us, that's when we get it. So those are kind of gone. Demolition ordinance is gone because I went to FX's office and the light went on, and that will be part of the what we do regarding the advisory heritage and that whole system there. That'll all be taken care of.
Yeah, but what I'm saying here, look at number one. It's not even a priority at the top. It's a low priority. So let's look at the balance of those are our top priorities and pick three of those.
But I don't see why. I mean, property maintenance ordinance and junkyard ordinance is something that we're required by state to do the junkyard ordinance. We can take that out of the RSA book type it up in ordinance form and sign, seal, and deliver it.
It was supposed to be done months ago, yeah.
With just a few changes. Budget issues are going to be ongoing, because mm-hmm. that's going to be coming up, so that's something that's an ongoing situation. The historical district, like I said, that's in the works already. The communications that you mentioned, the strategic planning, I don't know that the charter says committees. I think they said planning board, conservation.
No, it said committees.
It says committees?
Specifically committees, I think is what I saw. Should have a annual meeting with the various committees. And not only that, it's also been kind of asked by some of the staff people. We don't know what this department's working on, what this department's working on. It'd be great if we all had one meeting where we sat one day and said, what is it you're doing? What is it you're doing? How can we help you get that done?
But I don't know if it, at this stage right now, between the energy audit, which is very important to do, and everything else, the water, Black Bear, and so forth, I don't know if we should get into that aspect. We have counselors giving us committee reports. We have other committees that councils aren't on coming in and reporting to us. And to start getting involved with them when we have all this left to do right now, I think would be a waste of our time.
That's your opinion, but I want you to understand something. You folks are the one that prioritize this, not me.
Yeah, well, you know, now that we see it in front of us, too, we could say, and I think a lot of this is already in the works, and it's just a matter of scheduling it and doing it.
Okay.
And not letting it fall through the cracks.
Okay. We have two other councils. Councilor Carr.
Maybe instead of doing three, picking three, we take the top. We take two and six, which are at the top there,
yep,
along with the other ones that we're already working on all the time.
Right.
And just keep the and see how we can get with that. If we can get some of these other things out of the way, then we can go to the other ones.
That's fine with me.
Go to two instead of three.
Okay. So you're saying two and six?
Yep, those are the ones that had the
highest,
the okay, higher number, so that we're not already working on. And the other ones have to continue, so.
And Councilor Minitelli?
I'm not going to select a specific item from this list, but I just, you know, my thoughts on this are there are 14 goals listed on this sheet, all of which got at least one vote. So I'm perfectly happy just receiving an update periodically from the administrator, and as long as it's on the agenda, and we know that these issues are being worked on in some capacity and aren't falling through the cracks, you know, I'm happy to leave it at that, and we can just move on.
Okay. Rather than set up a procedure on how we get there.
It's my thoughts.
However, hers is going to be a little bit different on number six, because we were discussing some of the issues that we would like to, and perhaps what you might want to do.
We're going to have to work on that one.
Work on that one, yeah. Okay. And bring it to us. Councilor Bertrand.
I feel like this prioritization that we've done is too rigid, because things change, you know. It should be more liquid. As things come up, we should be able to make it a number one priority. And if it's being worked, then it goes kind of at the back of the pack for a while until something happens, so. Mm-hmm. Maybe, you know, this prioritization is kind of hamstringing us.
Yeah.
Well, that's the feedback I want.
So, you know, and maybe, you know, these are all important things, and we should just be working them at them. And, you know, in your FYI and updates, if you could just give us an update every week, it's fine by me also.
Yeah, and maybe some of the counselors on their own can say, take some initiative and say, well, this is the one I like on. Like, Councilor Carr is going to work on number six and get some input from that. All right, so
okay. What
we decided here is that we're not actually going to pick one, two, or three, or four. We're going to list them all as our priority, and we're going to have the town administrator look at that direction and say, this is where we set these priorities, and give us an update on how we're doing with those priorities. Is that correct, Mr. Cantelli? Did I get that right?
Yep.
Okay.
I think that's reasonable.
Okay. Very good. So, let's move on to item number
reports, appointments, eight.
Yeah. And I got to cross these off because I don't remember. Okay, number eight. All right. The first one we have is Advisory Heritage Commission, Jen Jarvis, and this would be for a term until May of 2010. We have a motion.
I'll entertain a motion to have Jen Jarvis nominated to the Advisory Heritage Commission for a term of...
May 10.
Oh, until... Her term would expire May 10th. May 2010, sorry.
Do we have a second on that?
Second.
Okay. She's the only one, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Any discussion?
I have some discussion.
Yeah, but I shut it off.
I don't believe that Jennifer Jarvis would be suitable to sit on the Advisory Heritage Commission. I'll point out that commission mandate is the commission shall ensure the proper recognition, use, and protection of resources that are valuable for the historical, cultural, aesthetic, or community significance within their natural, built, or cultural context. Was it last year or so? Ms. Jarvis says in her application that she owns property downtown in the proposed historic district. And we all know that her property is the 164 Main Street, which is the Lamprey River Tavern. It's in the Mathis...
Riverworks.
Riverworks. And it's the Mathis block, and it is listed on the National Register of Historic Places. And last year there was an incident where I think three chimneys were taken down. It is a very important piece of property, and in the process of the chimneys coming down, I guess there wasn't a permit and so forth and so on, so Dan didn't know it was happening that day. It was water-struck bricks from the 1840 that was taken down. The Historical Society and the Advisory Heritage was not informed about it. And Councilor Glennon, at that point, the day this occurred, happened to be in the town hall, and the code enforcement officer asked him his opinion. He was on the Advisory Heritage at the time, and that is how Councilor Glennon got involved with the conversation regarding what was going on that day with the chimneys coming down and the slate roof being removed and plain asphalt roofs being replaced. Ms. Jarvis was chair of the town council at the time, and I stood here publicly. I wasn't on the council at the time, and at that meeting following that incident, she, as chair of the council, removed Councilor Glennon from the Advisory Heritage because he was asked certain questions about it. And that to me was complete retaliation. She abused her power as a chair when she did that. And in light of what she did to a historic building, she has shown complete disregard for the historical preservation of a downtown area. And therefore, she does not fit the criteria to be on the Advisory Heritage. I don't know if everyone was aware of all that had happened. She didn't even try to replace the slate roof with anything aesthetically pleasing. And she was aware of the process going on. We had discussed with her as she was on the previous council the efforts of the Advisory Heritage trying to preserve the downtown and what we were trying to do. And she just went ahead and did that.
Thank you. No other questions? We'll do a roll call on that one. For Councilor Jarvis to serve a term of May until May of 2010.
Councilor Quox?
Nay.
Councilor Bergeron?
Aye.
Councilor LaBranch?
Aye.
Councilor Minutelli?
Aye.
Councilor Carr?
Nay.
Chairman Glennon?
Nay. Motion fails. Not enough votes. All right, let's move on to property owner term to expire for the Black Bear TIF in May of 2011. Mike Ricker of 26 Beach Street, who is also a property owner within the district. I will entertain a motion for Mike Ricker to be placed on the Black Bear TIF.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? No lights? Roll call, please.
Council Quox.
Aye.
Council Bergeron.
Nay.
Council LaBranche.
Nay.
Council Minutelli.
Nay.
Council Carr.
Aye.
Chairman Glennon.
Aye. Motion fails. I will entertain a motion for the ZBA. Does this say application appointment for
ZBA.
Board? ZBA. Okay. It's not the same application, it looks like. Okay. ZBA for term to expire in May of 2011 for Michael Watson.
I move that he be placed on the ZBA for the term ending in 2011. Michael Watson, sorry.
Michael. Did I say it wrong?
No, no, you said it fine.
Okay.
I didn't
do we have a second on that? He's currently serving, by the way, as a alternate to the planning board, and he's really doing a great job.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on this? Roll call.
Council Quox.
Aye.
Council Bergeron.
Aye.
Council LaBranche.
Aye.
Council Minutelli.
Aye.
Council Carr.
Aye.
Chairman Glennon.
Aye.
Motion carries. Mr. Winalski, please see that they they got letters on this.
What about Clay Mitchell?
He's not here.
He did submit one, didn't he, Clay Mitchell?
It's not in the package.
Not in the package.
No, I didn't see one. Well, we know he wants to be on it, so.
Yeah, and he's.
We told him tonight he was on it.
Yep.
Better put him on it, right?
It might be a good idea to put him on it and get it done with.
I could have sworn he was on it.
He changed his mind.
You have what? He's on the agenda, right?
Yeah.
That's what I thought. I know I saw it somewhere.
It says Energy Committee, Clay Mitchell.
Oh, he's here to speak.
That was it?
Yeah.
Oh, because I saw the other three names. This is the fourth one I figured.
Oh, maybe.
Yeah, that's right. Maybe it's supposed to be on there, but we don't have it, so.
All right. The next one is the council.
Aren't you going to do that?
Should we have a motion to?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
To do what? Appoint Clay Mitchell.
Oh, I thought we weren't going to do it because we didn't have his application.
Yeah. He just application.
That's.
I mean, I would vote. I have no problem with that.
I'm in as a formality, I would just prefer to have his application.
Understood.
And you know, obviously, I want him on there.
All right, so we'll get him on the agenda. He has to submit the application first. Okay, so the workshops, you folks wanted this to be broken down into categories. You know what? How come I have? Wait a minute, something's not right here. How come we have nine? Item number nine. I'm sorry. I gotcha. I'm tired. What I don't see here on the item B, Councilor Bergeron, Conservation Commission, I don't see any minutes there.
There are none that I can find. I haven't got any items myself.
Did you meet in August?
Yes, but we last met on September 11th.
Yeah, so you wouldn't have those minutes, but at least August minutes.
I haven't seen them.
And the Municipal Audit Committee, I don't see any minutes there either.
Let me see. I can get copies because Don Parnell was there, and he basically, I don't know who's supposed to be doing the minutes on the Municipal Audit. We all know why I can't do it because I
haven't. Do you have a secretary recording?
I can get that to you because Don was there, and he basically, we wanted a copy of the trustees' report, and he gave us a copy of the letter forwarded to Melanson and Heath with our responses from their audit committees, their comments, and when the next meeting was coming on the audit. He doesn't have a definite date for that. And highlights of the trust fund,
and a copy of the letter that was forwarded to Heath. So we've got basically everything, and some information on what the new employee upstairs in the finance office, Carol Sheenan, has completed and accomplished since she's been there. So I can get a copy of John's cover letter, it'll be fine.
It's just that I'm not seeing these minutes, and we all agree that the minutes should be in our packet. Mm-hmm. So I would ask the board to please go back to your respective boards and mm-hmm. let them know there is a state RSA out there that does require those minutes. If we're not getting them, I'm assuming Kathy's not getting them, and that's why they're not in here. Okay, so Councilor LaBranch, anything on any of your committees?
Energy audit, obviously we spoke about that this evening. CIP committee, we should be gearing that up very shortly, but it has not started. Budget committee, we should be starting to work on the school probably in the beginning of October, I would think. So we'll start gearing up.
Do you have a schedule yet for December set up yet for our budget?
There's no schedule that's been set up with the budget committee. I know you had instructed me to make sure that we didn't have conflicting schedules, and I brought that to the chair, and I believe that that's going to take place where the full budget committee, if they want to be, will be here. So that's pretty much where that is. And the Black Bear TIF, you all should have a report that I put together, and if there's any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Let's go back to the budget for a second, if we could. On the budget, I've gotten a couple of phone calls, and I don't know why it's happening, that the budget committee is meeting, and sometimes it's like at the last moment, but it's not being broadcast because Chris is not around on that particular date.
No, I can explain that. The last meeting that we did have was when they had the glitch with the system and it was unable to be televised. Then there was also another meeting that was held that was conflicting with ZBA, I believe. They did broadcast it on the handheld downstairs, but the quality was so bad, I think it ran like one or two times because you couldn't even hear the discussion.
You have a hard time when you do that with the audio, right. too, I think.
Right. That was basically it. You couldn't hear any of it. So the last meeting, I can tell you, was not on television because the system was down. That was when there was that glitch. And there hasn't been a meeting since then. But, you know, I'm sure they'll be on in the future.
Okay. Councilor Bergeron?
Is he going to touch base on Black Bear TIF?
I'll answer any questions that I can.
Go ahead. Black Bear TIF, how many members do you have now, Mike? You have Gary and Sue Levy.
I have five, counting myself, there's five members on that board as we speak.
Levy.
Planning Board Rep, NCDC Rep, and myself.
Okay.
And Mike Greco would have been the
NCDC.
Sixth.
And council.
Well, five based on the ordinance. Yeah.
So that has five, and you make the sixth?
Correct.
Okay. All righty.
Four. No. I make the fifth.
Right, you now make the fifth. The fifth. Okay, but we have room for one more person.
One more property owner, correct.
One more property owner. And can I ask why you didn't want Mike Ricker on there? Have you ever worked with Mike?
I've had an instance while I was on planning board with Mr. Ricker. I didn't feel it was necessary to go into long, drawn-out discussion about it. That's what I based my vote on.
Okay. All right. But and use our meeting on the 24th?
25th, I believe
it
is.
The 25th? Okay. All right, good. So that's up and running.
We'll see you on the 25th.
Well, you've got a...
Officers have to be at that meeting too, right?
Well, that's good. You know, you've gotten that.
There's a chair person right now, and I've turned the duties over. As I stated, I've turned the duties over to the chairperson to set it up.
Good.
Thank you. Mr. Bergeron, you're off the hook on the conservation, but what's happening there as far as the minutes?
We're getting ready for the Fall Harvest Festival. We'll be having a kiosk down there, an information kiosk. We'll be selling rain barrels and composters there, as well as calendars for the Southeast Land Trust. We'll be giving boat rides down the channel. They last about 20 to 25 minutes. We'll be going to the mouth of Great Bay and back.
The gondola?
Just that it's going to be a power boat.
A power boat, okay.
We also, on our last meeting, discussed the Graziano property proposal on Neil Mill Road and drafted a letter of our concerns. We furnished the town council and the planning board with those concerns, copies of those. That's it for conservation. Forensic audit, we met September 9th. We discussed the report with legal counsel. They have it in their hands now. They're doing a review and any necessary revisions. Then we're going to meet one more time. We're going to review it and vote to accept it and turn it over to the town council ultimately.
So the date that we have set up for next, is it next week? You have a calendar?
Should be the
24th. Will it be ready for the 24th? Because I have it set up on.
So far, so good. Okay. So it looks like it's doable.
I know Councilor Wheat, I used to call him Wheaton, but Councilor Wheat, their attorney, indicated that he has a trial and they're going to be selecting the jury on the 22nd. So I just want the council to be aware that that is a floating date at this point, the 24th. It's all contingent on what happens with his trial. And he says it could be one of those situations where they'll select the jury and then it may not have to use them and it might be settled. So just keep that. So if I call you and say, we're not going to be discussing it, it's not something I've done that's out of my hands on that. Okay. Vice Chair Carr, Planning Board.
Last week we met and came up with what we hope is our final draft on the M1. There will be a meeting, a public meeting on the 30th of September for the townspeople to discuss it. We hope we can get a better turnout than we had last time because there were very few people there, even very few abutters. And my fear in particular is that if people don't give their say right now, that, you know, up in the future it's going to come back and bite us.
This is for what, Judy?
This is for the M1.
The M1.
So hopefully we can get more people to come to the public forum for that. And last night we had a meeting. It was just a kind of a general stuff going on. There are two, as Councilor Bergeron mentioned, there are two projects on Neil Mill Road, which is a Class 6 road. And I believe that in one of the cases, the gentleman wants to build a home and a barn. And the planning board doesn't say yay or nay, but we've given a recommendation to the town council. So we're working on that, trying to see if, because there are all sorts of problems with getting electricity and all into it on a Class 6 road. But otherwise, it was pretty much business as usual.
So that request that you had on the Mill Rose Class 6 is coming to the council?
Eventually, yes. It will be a little while.
We don't need to do anything.
You don't need to do a thing about it.
I was going to ask the administrator to pencil that in for October, but we'll wait till we get the...
I'm not even sure if it'll be ready in October.
We'll wait till we get the official request, and I believe Councilor Branch may have a question for you.
Actually, just a statement for the vice chair. I'd like her to go back to the planning board and express my gratitude for the efforts that they have put into this M1 district to get this thing moving and get it before the council. I think they've done above and beyond.
Can we all weigh in on that too and say the same?
You're more than welcome to, but I think that, you know, should not go unnoticed. They've really done their due diligence on this.
Thank you. They will appreciate that.
And I think to add just a side note to that, we may want to really seriously start thinking and asking the planning board, and it has to come from the council, to start looking at the M4 down the other end. I'm not sure if it's premature that some things might be happening down there, but we may want to sort of set that over to them and have them look at it. Keep that in the back of your head, please. I'm next. We did not do the Riverwalk last week because we had a council meeting, so I had to, that preempted our Riverwalk meeting. So, and you pretty much heard tonight what we were going to talk about. Councilor Quarks on the Heritage Advisory, Municipal Audit Committee, and Municipal Solid Waste.
I basically told you Advisory Heritage, we're meeting with, they turned a lot of information over to Diane. We're going to do October 14th at Planning, October 15th at Council. Municipal Audit, I read that little report from Dawn, the meeting we had then. And Municipal Solid Waste, I looked into that. Evidently, they haven't met since 2002.
What is that exactly?
I have the ordinance, and I guess at their last meeting, they were going to revise it, and it got tabled. People were not in favor of it. And I don't know if they tend to just meet near contract time.
Oh, is that what picks up our trash?
That's what, our trash.
Our trash.
That's our trash.
Do we have a committee for that?
Yes.
Because you have to negotiate the contract. Check the
first
contract.
One to go.
And and unlike, you know, the Black Bear TIF, this committee is, it was code enforcement officer, planner.
What is this you're talking about?
The waste.
Solid waste.
Solid waste committee. It was code enforcement officer, planning.
Administrator.
Administrator. Rick Malasky would be on there, and council. I think it's 5 or 6, I forget which, but I have the ordinance here. I spoke to Diane to let her know. Dan's away at a conference all week, just to let him know that. So I basically have to do what Mike did and contact all these people and let them know that we're going to have to stop meeting. But is it something that we should do just during contract time? And when is their contract coming up again?
That I don't know. I'd have to talk to Rick or get a copy of it.
Okay. So
if
I mean,
they haven't met in 6 years, I mean.
Yeah.
Probably coming up in a few.
Yeah.
I know it's one of those that they get the town of Newfields, they get Stratum, and they get Newmarket, and they negotiate volume, I guess, of how much trash, and the tipping charges. I guess there's a cost with the tipping over in Rochester. It's really a very large, but when it's done, it's settled, it's done for about 3 years.
Well, I was going to say, it probably should be a working group and not a committee, not a
exactly.
Standing committee.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. As far as I know, you're going to have everything a working committee.
So I'll find out when they're...
If I can, I will.
So I'll get in touch with Dan when he comes back. He's ready for conferences all week, I think.
Well, I think the best person to contact would be...
Excuse me.
Rick, yeah. And we can find out when the contract expires, and I'll see when everyone can meet.
Thank you. Councilor Pulaski is out sick, so the only thing I will add there for him, under the Main Street Committee... As everybody knows, the Heritage Festival is this weekend. It starts Friday night, Saturday, Sunday. I'm not sure if they're doing a chowder fest on Friday night, which is the traditional thing.
Saturday.
Saturday night. It is Saturday night? Okay. It's a wonderful opportunity for all the different ethics groups. What are you doing?
No.
He's saying no?
No, Ed and I were asked if we would dish out chowder, so I'm making believe I'm leaving.
Oh, okay. I thought you saw you go like this.
No, like
what
this.
Are you doing? You can't like do that.
Be like a lunch lady.
So the committee.
Lunch lady.
You sure you wear your hair done?
Yeah. The committee has done a great job on that because I was fortunate to serve 2 years in a row as co-chair with the former chief of police, Rod Collins, and it's a lot of work goes into it. And believe it or not, when they're done on Sunday night, they take about 3 weeks to 4 weeks, and they start planning for the following year. And a lot of this is grant monies they get from the charitable foundations, various entities, the Council on the Arts. A lot of work goes into this, and I want to extend a real appreciation to all of that committee who puts it together, and particularly Suki Kasala, who has been the lead on this for many years, and she's done a tremendous job, and I appreciate it all. So, Councilor Minatelli, you're the next one.
The Downtown TIF Advisory Board met in August, I think it was August 7th, and voted to make a recommendation to the Town Council with respect to expenditure of TIF money on repair of the town clock, the downtown clock, and I think all councilors received a memo on that. Open Space met this month, I think September 8th, and it was in basically an introductory meeting. New members, there was some brief discussion about town-owned land out by Lidl Lane that is open space right now, and I imagine that that'll be discussed further in further meetings there. And the Veterans Memorial Trust has been meeting consistently last night, and they're following up on their charge from the town. The discussion, to some extent, they discussed, I had to leave early last night, I'll say that, but they did discuss having their council rep read a proclamation for Chris Hawkins for establishing their committee.
Those are usually secret.
Well,
we surprise them.
Well,
surprise.
It'll be it's not going to be secret because I think they talked about it last night and instructed someone to contact him about it so that he can be present for it. So there's no secret there, and they accepted the resignation of they're kind of getting their membership rolling. Somebody, I think what had happened in that committee is there had been some people who weren't consistently attending meetings, and so those people have now all resigned, and there are some new potential new members, I think, some people who are interested, and we'll probably be seeing some applications from them soon.
Good. I'm glad you brought that up, because I had asked the staff today to pull for me the letters of resignation, and in 1 year time we have approximately six people that have resigned, and that was my concern. This
from that committee.
From that committee. We see in the patent here, what's going on, but perhaps it might be those who have not been attending and realize. I mean, somebody moved, I know that, and then somebody was sick and things like that, but. Where this is a public thing, and we talk about it publicly, the question is going to be inevitably, what's happening with this committee? You don't see that numbers, those numbers in other committees, though. But you just explained it.
That's my understanding.
Yep. Great. Thank you. Thank you for all your reports. Old business, new business? Councilor LaBranche.
Just a couple of things. I received some phone calls over the last couple of weeks, and I'm not sure. This is probably, I don't know if this is a planning board issue or if it's a council issue, but cell reception, wireless reception within the town of Newmarket is poor. And I know one of my last meetings as a member of the planning board, they approved another set of towers going up on the water tower. And I don't believe that that's been done. And I don't know if it's being held up because they're waiting for the second tower to go up or the second water tower to go up, which I didn't think it was because I thought originally it had been approved, but for some other cell company to put towers up there, they never did. Their time lapsed, so we ended up going with another firm. But it's something that, some of the citizens are getting a little concerned about. Very poor reception, and it sounds like Vice Chair Carr might have some answers.
I don't know if they're full answers. This has come before us. I'm trying to think what's happening right now. I think it has to do with either a right-of-way issue or power to the area, but it is being worked on, and it has come before us, and I don't think there's a major problem except just getting it done. So.
Okay.
I'd have to go back to the minutes to be sure of that.
Okay. I mean, if we can just maybe check into it and find out what the status is, because I know a lot of people, their cell phones are their only source of phones these days. Why have a landline when you pay 50, 60, 70 bucks a month for a cell phone? So, and I think one of the companies is setting up, the Wi-Fi for your computers and stuff. And if you're getting bad reception and it just happens to be where you live, you're tied into either going with, someone like Comcast or whatever, another phone company. So it's just something that it's not on our goals, but I think it's something that, we should just pay a little bit of attention to and see if we can't sort that out, especially with our nice downtown coming in place. I'd hate to see no reception while people are down there doing things, walking around. That was a...
Before you go any further, right. I think there's other questions on that issue.
Okay.
Mr. Winowski.
The answer to give at this point is a email that I received from our attorney that's been handling working with the Verizon people. Is it's all been engineered. However, when it got to one of the divisions, they said, "Does that tank have lead on it?" So now they're doing a test on the paint on the tank to make sure there isn't lead. So that's the only thing that's holding it up right now.
Okay.
And that is something I'm going to sort of speak for you. Those are the kind of things we want to hear in these reports, updates, you know, and your weekly report. That's the whole, because I can't use my cell phone in this town unless I go to the Rite Aid parking lot, and that's the only place I can use my cell phone.
Okay.
So, thank you.
And I do have one other.
No, I'm just shutting his light off.
Also, I've received some calls about, apparently the superintendent of schools had requested to be on the agenda beginning of this month. I think it might have been for the business meeting. He was apparently on the agenda, got bumped off at the last minute. Just wanted to come in to introduce himself, let the council know who he was. I've met him because being on the budget committee, he came to one of the budget meetings. And you know, I mean, if you met him on the street, I don't think anybody would know who he was, with the exception of maybe the administrator. But you know,
he was not bumped off the agenda. I had a conversation with the chair of the school board the night we had the vote downstairs for the DPW, and so at that point he wasn't officially on the agenda because we hadn't set the agenda. So when I talked with Cliff, I said, wouldn't it be better to have him come in at a joint meeting with his ideas, his proposals of a joint meeting on cost-saving measures? Cliff and I both agreed to that. He was going to go back to the superintendent and express that to him. And I said, would you like me to do that? Because I'm the one that's kind of suggesting this. And he goes, no, that's fine. I'll do that, and I'll get back to you. That's the conversation we had downstairs.
I think the main purpose of him coming to the council was to introduce himself and start the lines of communications going, which I think this council has talked about, having communication with the school. I'm sure that it probably would have taken him all of 10 or 15 minutes to introduce himself, tell him what his goals are, where he came from, and things of that nature, because that's all it really took him when he introduced himself to the budget committee. But I guess, you know, in order to show good faith here, I'd like to see if we can't get him on our next agenda at the business meeting and move him early. So
the October, and he's coming in the very next week.
He is coming. Does he know
I
that?
I have him on the schedule. We just need to confirm that.
We're setting up a joint meeting between the school board and the town council to discuss energy matters, et cetera, efficiencies. So there would be a opportunity to see him then.
But not for him to come in prior.
That's
okay. That's fine. I think, you know, that's fine.
Your point's well taken. Thank you. Any other new old motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
Anybody who wants to stay? All those aye.
Aye.
Well, excuse me, sir. Would you just introduce yourself to the council to who you are?